solo sogno l'orizzonte e mancano le parole. Sì, lo so che non c'è luce in una stanza quando manca il sole. Se non ci sei tu, con me su le finestre mostrar tutto il mio cuore che è acceso. Chiudi dentro me la luce che ho incontrato per strada.
Good morning. We're going to go ahead and get started right now. But on behalf of City Reach Church and Pastor Brian and the entire team here, we just want to welcome each and every one of you here. And on behalf of our church and our church family, our deepest condolences to the family during this time. And we understand that even in the midst of moments like these, we can still lean into the grace and love of Jesus Christ that brings comfort above all things. And this morning I'm going to be reading on behalf of Pastor Jessica, who was the former youth and associate pastor here for 7 years. And so this is her writing, and so all right, I'll read on her behalf. I wanted to share about Marilyn Juarez. As you all know, she was a woman of faith, character, and extreme perseverance. She never lacked a smile and a genuine hug. I feel like so much of how she lived her life made everyone around her feel cared for and loved. She served breakfast to so many at Grace Community, Palm View Assembly of God over the years. I would go to the cafe to just chat with her. She made the best breakfast burritos and hot cocoa. She never skipped out on blessing youth with trips to youth conventions or helping cook for fundraisers. I was so blessed to see your heart for the students. Then there was my family. We have been there for us through a lot over the years. Marilyn truly loved my baby girl, Amelia. Even before she was born, she helped make the food presentation at the baby shower the best ever. And after leaving Grace Community, she continued to love on us, blessing us in so many ways. I know that you are in heaven now, fully restored to the glory with Christ Jesus. Can I get an amen? Marilyn made life on earth look like a blessing, even in her toughest moments. She made faith in Christ real to those that doubt or don't believe. She made service to others a part of her life and mission. She truly was the best representation of Christ and his love and character. I will miss you, but I can't wait to join you in heaven. 1 Peter 1:6-9 says this: in all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief and all kinds of trial. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are received the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. Pastor Jessica also has a prayer she would like for us to agree with. Let's pray. Today, God, we thank you for your word that reminds us that though we suffer grief in all kinds of trials, that you are with us. You were with Marilyn through her journey here on earth until her last breath. You promised her and us inexpressible and glorious joy. We saw Marilyn's joy here on earth, even in her toughest moments, because she knew you, Jesus. Jesus, thank you for giving us the opportunity to know Marilyn and to see her love for you and for others. Thank you, Jesus, for allowing her service to you in turn bless so many of us here in this room. It's our honor today to come together and celebrate her life. May all we say and do today bring glory to you, much like Marilyn's life and service did. Amen. Amen. At this time, we're going to have Evelyn come and say the eulogy.
Good morning, everyone. On behalf of my husband, Javier Guillen, my mom, we just want to extend our deepest condolences to the family. Javier's not here with us this morning because he had a heart procedure last week, and the doctor said that he couldn't be out in public. I had the pleasure of knowing Marilyn for 30 years, and it was in this very same auditorium that I met her. Marilyn was born on October 15, 1947, in Sunnyside in the state of Washington. She is preceded in death by her parents, Juan Juarez and Amelia Juarez. She is also survived by her sister, Carolyn Pregana, brother-in-law, Danny Pregana, brothers Lonnie Robertson and Lyle Lint, nephew Jay Palacio, niece by marriage, Jaylin Palacio, great-niece Alexis Palacio, great-nephew Eric Palacio, great-great-nephew Alexander Ryan Palacio, and great-great-niece Raylin Nicole Palacio. The hard part about writing a eulogy or an obituary is this. How can you possibly begin to sum up in a few words or a couple of pages all that Marilyn meant and continues to mean to each of us? Let's face it, it's impossible. You see, if you were privileged to have known Marilyn because you're related to her or one of her close friends or one of her many clients through the years, there is nothing I can possibly say that you don't know already. However, I am confident that we would all agree that Marilyn loved life and she loved the Lord. More importantly, or not as importantly, she loved people and doing things for people. She was the epitome of what it means to be a servant leader. And she always led by example. Marilyn would always step up, offer to make a meal for a sick friend or a family member, run the cafe at church, help out in whatever way she could with her time and money. She was caring, kind, generous, accepting of others, and so gentle. She could cry with you and laugh with you. I can only imagine that Jesus met her at the gates of heaven and said, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter in and rest." I vividly remember when she got the news of her illness. She was determined to fight it. This beast of an illness was not going to control her life or stop her from living. She knew it was serious, the prognosis bleak, and her time with us uncertain. At one point, her doctor told her, "If there are any trips you want to make, now's the time to do it." So along with a couple of friends, Darlene and Elaine, the four of us took a trip to New York City. Marilyn had the best time ever, and we enjoyed watching her enjoy the sights. A year later, we all got together again and took a trip to New Mexico. Although she was slowing down by then, she never, never let on that she was feeling ill. She was always still concerned about us and how we were doing. To her immediate family, Marilyn was strength. In Jay's words, he was blessed to have two moms. In Jaylin's words, she admired and looked up to Marilyn and appreciated how she always took care of everyone's hair and made Christmas so special. In Carolyn's words, the sisterly bond is evident in the following sentiment that Carolyn shared with her sister. "Sis, I just want you to know that you mean the world to me. It's been a joy living with you the past few years and a tremendous honor caring for you. There is nothing I wouldn't do for you. My daily prayer is that you don't have to suffer and won't be in pain, and I believe God will grant this for you. I love you always and forever." And I just want to say thank you to Carolyn and her family for taking such incredible care of Marilyn. It's speechless. In closing, I would just like to share a very short poem that encapsulates what we think about Marilyn. God saw you getting tired. A cure was not meant to be. So he put his arms around you and whispered, "Come with me." With tearful eyes, we watched you and we saw you fade away. Although we loved you dearly, we couldn't make you stay. A golden heart stopped beating, your tender hands at rest. God took you home to prove to us he only takes the best. God bless you.
Thank you so much, Evelyn. At this time, I'd ask that Renee and Yolanda, they're going to be giving some remembrance remarks. They'll come to the stage at this time.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Yolanda Rora Hastings. I have been a friend of Marilyn, Carolyn, and the family for like 47 years, a really long time. And I'm honored to stand here and be able to represent my family that couldn't be here and to just love on the memory of who Marilyn was. I have been asked to read Miss Maria Camarillo. I'm going to read something that she wrote and she couldn't be here. So I'm going to take off my glasses. I could read better. It says, it is my honor and privilege to share a few words about Marilyn Juarez. When Marilyn's parents, the Reverend John Juarez and his wife Amelia, lived in the state of Oregon, they were a great source of support and encouragement to my mother, the Reverend Flora Vergara. And as she began her ministry planting churches in the state of Oregon, reaching monolingual Spanish-speaking individuals, my mother would always talk about the blessings they were to her and how they would look after her and support her in her ministry. Who knows that when the Lord opened passage for me to begin a ministry to women in recovery known as the Third Step Ministry in the LA area, Marilyn and I would cross paths and team up in ministry. Marilyn's love for Jesus was evident from the moment we met, and she had great enthusiasm when she embraced the women that were in recovery. She loved the concept of hosting women for an elegant lunch and showering them in a tangible way with the love of Jesus. She had no qualms about sitting next to women who were different from her as day and night. Women coming out of their addiction with stories of brokenness, pain, hurt, and tragedy. Marilyn did what Marilyn does best. She loved and she served. She simply served the 8 women who were seated at her table in whatever state they were in and extended love and acceptance as Jesus would have. The Third Step event was a once a year outreach, but she knew that throughout the year we had to fundraise, train our volunteers, and collect goodie bags filled with feminine items to give to the ladies. So Marilyn rallied other women to contribute goodie bags and door prizes. She helped me organize a training at her church to prepare volunteers to serve Jesus. When hosting in her church, she made sure the coffee was prepared and brought refreshments for volunteers to enjoy during the time of training. And of course, Marilyn was the first to register as a volunteer and give above and beyond that the Third Step outreach could go forward as plans. Marilyn did this year after year, faithfully serving Jesus's girls. Anyone that knows Marilyn knows exactly the type of person she was to step up. It's like she took great joy in serving and making cookies or burritos or whatever. You know, I've known Marilyn since I was 18 years old, and I was always like so impressed of the woman that she was. I remember her back in 1973, I think it was, or 74, when she fashioned that platinum blonde hair and those jumpsuits, the bell-bottom jumpsuits. And it was like, I want to be like Marilyn. And she had a car and she would take me. I remember she was the person that took me the first time to the Velvet Turtle and I had prime rib. I was like, wow, I was so impressed. This little girl from East LA, you know. And so I have good memories of Marilyn. Of course, if you know who I am, Carolyn, her sister, is my best friend. Always, she's in my heart. And I grieve that she's gone, but I'm also very happy in knowing that Marilyn shone what it is to be a Christian person. I'm going to read you the 9 attributes that are in Galatians 5:22 and 20 through 23 that talks about the attributes or the fruits of the Holy Spirit. And you can make your own checklist on your mind, but I want you to remember a time when Marilyn brought you joy, and the time that she showed you love. I want you to think about the peace that she had in Jesus. She fought a battle that I called her my hero, because I don't know how much peace, even though I know the Lord, how much peace I would have going through what she did. And Marilyn definitely showed this. She had kindness. Remember the time that she showed goodness, her faithfulness, her gentleness, and when she practiced self-control. These are the attributes of the Holy Spirit, and I think we can check them off one by one. And I just want to say, you know, look upon her as an example in our lives. And I know that she has fought the battle successfully, because to be absent here is to be in the presence of the Lord. So I know she's happy. So when you want to be down about her absence, just think about where she's at and think about the good things off this list that she indwelled in her life and shared out to others. God bless you.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Renee Wattis Medina, and my husband and I are representing my entire family here today. I wrote what I have prepared on the evening after. Okay. This is weird, because usually I'm a robot with no emotions, and here they are. So I'm going to get through this. Marilyn. So Marilyn was like the older sister that I never had, and that was nice. Marilyn. The opposite of me in every way. Beautiful, gentle, soft in her words and voice. Generous to a fault, tender in everything she did. She is part of my earliest memories. She has been a constant in my life. She gave all 3 of my boys their first haircuts. And I'm pretty sure she gave me my first boy's haircut. See, I was 5 and I complained about the daily torment of having my hair brushed. So my mom took me to Aunt Emily's beauty shop, and I came out with a pixie, which is what they called a boy's number 2 haircut on a girl. Marilyn drove Jay to the hospital at midnight the night I had my son Nicholas, because he needed to be there. Marilyn and her friend Margie came to Maui when Andy and I got married there. Marilyn was probably the best person I've ever known. Really, you know, intrinsically good. She didn't get angry. She wasn't crazy or sarcastic or a bitch the way some of us Wattis women can be. Sorry. She didn't use curse words. She told people she loved them right out loud. She loved and honored her parents. She loved God and served her church community until the cancer took that away from her. Basically, Marilyn was the epitome of kindness and grace. Pretty much as I said earlier, the opposite of me. My mom called Marilyn number one daughter. She stayed with my parents every weekend for the past 4 years. She brought my mom food every time that my mom was in the hospital with my dad. She got my mom an Instant Pot, and she made my mom get the internet. Okay. God, I love that woman. And God, I hate cancer. On the day she passed, I had a funny story to tell her about a senior citizen old lady that I had honked at and how that old biddy had scolded me with a Russian accent. Marilyn would have laughed at that one. That's okay. I know she's standing in line at the pearly gates, all beautiful and transformed and excited about what's next. I miss her, that's all. But maybe if I play my cards right, I'll get to see her again. The last time I saw Marilyn, I was leaving my mom's house. I love you, I whispered. I love you too, she said. And Marilyn couldn't tell a lie.
Thank you. Thank you, Renee. At this time, I'm gonna ask Jimmy Barraza if he'll make his way to the stage and he'll be blessing us with a song.
I don't have anything prepared, but I'm going to speak from the heart. She was, wow, what a tough person she was. Caring and loving, very selfless. We had many a conversation in the cafe for years. She watched me grow. She watched me get married, my children. And it's because of her prayers, of course others as well, but hers also, that I'm standing here today. It was right over here just a few weeks ago. She hugged me tight. She cried. We cried. She looked up at me and I told her it was going to be okay. She said she knew it was going to be okay. But what she told me was she was tired. She was tired. And I know it's sad and it hurts that she's not here with us. But she's not tired anymore. She's much better. She's in a better place. And for that, I find solace. I feel happy that she's in a better place. She's not here suffering anymore. She's one of those people that lifts you up. She lifted you up when you were down. That smile, her laugh. That's who she was. She was one of those people. And I'm gonna sing this song, first of all, in God's honor, and in her honor as well.
My heart burdened me. then I am still in wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulder. You raise me up to more than I can be.
This time I'm going to ask that Carolyn make her way to the stage. She has some remembrance remarks.
Hi, everyone, and thank you for being here today. For those who don't know me, I'm Carolyn. I'm Marilyn's sister. I want to introduce to you my husband, Daniel Pergana. And I want to just say that about the time that Marilyn got ill, I was talking to my husband and I said, honey, I think it's time that we have Marilyn live with us. My husband is my rock. He has sustained me through these 4 years. Thank you, sweetheart. His response to me was, well, that's automatic. You know? Let's go pack her up and bring her over here. I'm talking a week later. The family, all the family, my Aunt Ruth and Uncle Junior, Renee, who was up here earlier, they all thought that was just the thing That was just automatic. That was a thing to do. And we did. Marilyn lived with us for approximately 4 years. I just wanted to let you know, too, that right now our heart is saddened, not only because my sister has passed, but it's also saddened because my granddaughter and my grandchildren, great-grandchildren, I should say, had their plane tickets ready to be here. And right before they were going to come, they had to make a decision because the children were all going to come with them. And because of this that's going on right now, she had to make a decision for her family, which we understand. Then my grandson came and was with us for the viewing of the immediate family. And then he got a text saying that his plane was going to be canceled to go home tomorrow. So we had to fly him out last night. So that saddens me. But I just want to say that my sister was an amazing woman. I loved everything about my sister. Her smile, her kindness. She was so gracious to everyone. Everyone loved her. And I know in my heart that if it wasn't for this virus that has come along, this church would be overflowing. I know that in my heart. I just want to tell everyone that I appreciate all the support of my family. My Aunt Lucy was always there and said, do you need anything? I would call her just to call her and tell her an update. And she goes, what's wrong? Are you okay? That was my Aunt Lucy. And she was very supportive of this whole journey that we went through for 4 years. My sister touched the infusion center. That's where she did her chemo. She had many, many treatments, countless treatments. But she loved it. Every one of those nurses that were there. The hospice, people that came to the house, they were amazing. And she just connects with everybody, every person she connects with. And Dr. Schmortzman called me when she found out my sister had passed and she had been treating her. And she told me, I am so sorry, I couldn't do more. She did a lot, a lot. Well, I want to tell you that my sister loved traveling, and there was this fearsome foursome. It was Darlene, Margie, Evelyn, and of course, Marilyn. They liked to travel a lot. When the years passed, Bonnie and Darlene's sister, Marilyn, I believe her name was also, and there was another sister, I can't remember all the names, but they also traveled with her. Marilyn did not let grass grow under her feet. I'm telling you, when she found out she was ill, she started planning trips. I cherish the memories of all my family in Washington that were very supportive of Marilyn. I remember Marilyn made a trip to Washington, and my sister was very close to both her families, but the Juarez's she lived around more, and the Orozco's she didn't live with. They were in Washington, Oregon. And the Ramos's, Macias's, Janet and Sherry, they were far, far away. So Marilyn was a workaholic, and she never, you know, left work, so she didn't travel to Washington as much as, you know, like Tokyo and other places she preferred to go to, Cancun. When she was ill, she says, I need to go to Washington. And she did go to Washington, and she reconnected with cousins that she hadn't been around for 40 years. And it was like automatic also. It was like a bond that was just formed right then and there, you know. They loved her, and they loved that she went over there and took that time. And this was the last 6 years of her life. And they were able to hug her and tell her how much they loved her. And they've supported her, you know, when she first got sick, and they're still supporting her financially now, you know, at the end. And we're grateful for that. And I don't want that to go unnoticed to them. You know, we love you. I have to talk about my Uncle Junior and my Aunt Ruth. You know, Marilyn lived with us for 4 years. And one day she told me, and not after 2 weeks that she was with us, she says, you know, I'm going to go stay with my Uncle Junior and my Aunt Ruth. And I go, oh, really? And she goes, oh, yes. She goes, you need your time. You need your time with your husband. She was always so, you know, concerned about others. So my aunt and my uncle also had her at their home for those 4 years. She would spend 3 or 4 days with me, and then she'd spend the weekend with them. And Monday, my sister was giving, so giving, that my Aunt Ruthie went swimming every Monday, and my sister was there until she came back, and then she'd come back to our home. And my aunt is a church person, and Marilyn was there so she could go to her services, to her mass. And then she would come home, and then Marilyn would come to her church until the end, where she couldn't probably come as often. But she was a faithful servant, and she loved this church. So I want you to know that I want to extend my gratitude to my uncle and my aunt. They loved her like a daughter, just like Renee said. I also have to tell you, I have a family member that told Marilyn, even 2 years before she retired, he says, you need to retire. You need to just stop working. Don't worry about anything. I will help you. And that he did, and his family. If he was here, he would be very upset that I'm even saying this. So I won't mention names, but I'm sure 90% of the people here know who that person is. I just want to extend my thanks to that family. I want to also say that Brother Isaac Gonzalez and Sister Cecilia were going to be here, and they're from another state far, far away where it snows. I'm not sure, Missouri, Minnesota, somewhere. But as you know, Arkansas, honey?
Yeah, I think so.
Arkansas. Oh, boy, was I wrong. Anyway, with everything that's going on, they couldn't make it. At the last minute, their hotel was already purchased. They had a car that they were going to drive. They had their plane tickets they had to cancel. We all know what's going on. But you know what? All I had to do was make a phone call to Pastor Bolts. And he said, we are here to serve you and your family. Look at this beautiful church he opened up for us. Without hesitation, I don't know everybody's name because I was not a member of this church, but I have gotten to know some of them. Vanessa, who has worked very hard, Pastor Rob, who's worked very hard, just stepped right up to the plate. And just, how can you thank a person that just does this? He says, you know, Carolyn, and I was fearful. I was fearful because of everything that's going on in the world right now. And I says, do I have to worry about anything? He said, no. These doors are going to be open for you and your family, and you have nothing to worry about. And look, we are here today. And the worry that I did have, I should have listened to him. But I'm a worrywart. What can I say? Pastor Boats, thank you so much for offering this sanctuary for us to have this service for my sister. And the fellowship hall for later. Thank you. I want to thank everybody who has participated. The food servers, the singers, the pastor, the volunteers, everyone. If I left you out, it's not because it was intentional. I want to thank each and every one of you who made it here today. And I know that that was a decision that you had to make. And I thank you from the bottom of my heart for being here. You are all loved. Marilyn loved you so much. That's all I can say is thank you and God bless you. And I hope you enjoy the rest of the day. And Marilyn, I love you, sis. And until we meet again, say hi to Mom and Dad and all those who have gone before us. Thank you so much.
The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. We know Marilyn is in paradise today with Jesus. Can I get an amen? And so I just want to share a few things briefly. Me and my wife, we love Marilyn. We loved her. She was a great woman of faith. She was a woman that loved Jesus. And she served this church for many years. I know there were so many people that wanted to share about her life. I got a call this morning from Pastor Don Sanderson and the former pastor here, and he wanted to share that Marilyn meant so much to him and his wife, and she served them faithfully. She served the church under him faithfully, and we are grateful that she is a faithful servant of God. Today we will mourn and we will share in our grief. We will support one another. And we will say goodbye. Our country and world is facing troubling times, but our hope is secure in Jesus Christ. Today, we will honor and celebrate our sister Marilyn. And we are also here to celebrate the life she led. And what an amazing life! What a life full of joy and full of the love of Jesus Christ. We mourn over the loss of our friend. We mourn over our loss of our sister in the Lord. But we are also here to say what a life she led and her faithfulness to Jesus. I want you to just understand a few things. She was a matriarch in her family, in her faith, and an inspiration and support to countless. Her faith, she was just a woman of faith. She was a servant of God, and she loved Jesus. I want to just speak a very simple message called Consider This. I want us to just consider three things. Why do we do this? Why do we come together during times like this? Why do we come together to celebrate life, but we also need to consider life during these times? We consider someone we think about seriously, taking into account, hearing them in our mind, regarding highly, look at, think about, reflect. When we consider, we do all these things. We reflect, we think, we meditate. And I want you to consider Marilyn. She was a woman that put Jesus first. Marilyn loved her family fiercely, always willing to do anything for her family or friends. Marilyn had a huge heart with anyone she met. If she never met a stranger. She never judged people. She just loved people and believed in people. Marilyn had so much joy. Her smile was contagious. Her joy was contagious. She had the joy of the Lord. And how many know the Bible says the joy of the Lord is our strength? Marilyn confessed Christ as her Savior. Her faith was the most important part of her life. Everything flowed from her faith. All relationships and all decisions. I want to read a passage of scripture as you right now, as we considered Marilyn, I want you to consider yourself. Matthew 7 verses 24 through 27 says this, "Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house on the sand. And the rains descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell. And great was its fall." Everyone is building some kind of foundation. I want to just speak to you for a moment here. We are building on a foundation. And that foundation either needs to be the foundation of Jesus Christ, or it's the foundation of your own choosing. But I'm here to tell you there's only one wise foundation. And that is the foundation built on the love of Jesus Christ. That Jesus loves us so much that he went to the cross and hung there and died for our sins. His blood was shed so we could spend eternity in heaven. The greatest foundation is on the rock of Jesus Christ. A wise man, a wise woman builds their house on the rock so that when trials come, when troubles come, when tribulations come, your house will not be destroyed. Your house will be built on this ageless foundation. And when it's built on that ageless foundation, through everything Marilyn went through, it did not shake her faith. It did not. Trials came, troubles came, tribulation came. But Marilyn's house was built on the rock of Jesus Christ. And the Bible says, "Death, where is your sting?" Marilyn understood something that was so priceless. That when your foundation is Jesus Christ, anything can come your way. But you have a blessed assurance that you will spend eternity in heaven with Jesus Christ. Isn't that such a great assurance? Can I get an amen on that? Proverbs 3, verse 5 and 6 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your paths." I want you to understand that maybe you have built your own house. And I'm here to tell you that house is on sand. If Jesus is not the foundation, that house will not last. Because there is a firm foundation. Don't lean on your own understanding, but trust in the Lord in all his ways. I want the last thing, after we consider Marilyn and considering yourself, I want you to consider Christ. John 14 verses 1 through 6 says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And where I go, you know, and the way you know." Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going, and how can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Romans 5 verse 8 says, but God demonstrates his own love towards us, and that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. I want you just for a moment, in these troubling times we are living in, to consider Jesus Christ, who the Bible calls the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who the Bible calls him the Prince of Peace, the Waymaker, the Bread of Life, the Lily of the Valley. As we've heard testimony after testimony of Marilyn's life, a woman of faith who built her house on the rock, I want you to consider yourself right now. And also I want you to consider Jesus Christ. He who knew no sin became sin, so that you could spend eternity like Marilyn in heaven. And I want you to know heaven is a real place. And Marilyn is in heaven with our Savior Jesus Christ. Marilyn is spending eternity with Jesus. Marilyn is worshiping our Savior right now. Marilyn is in heaven praising the name of Jesus. There is no greater name than the name of Jesus. And so I want you to consider Jesus, that he who knew no sin became sin. He came to this earth, lived a sinless life, went to the cross for our sins. Everything we've ever done wrong, when he hung on that cross, he did it for us. And 3 days later, the Bible says he rose from the grave with all power and authority. Jesus died. He was crucified so you could spend eternity in heaven, so your house could be built on a solid rock, the rock of ages, the rock that when you build on it, storms may come, trials may come, tribulation may come, but your house will remain firm in an assurance that Jesus will be faithful to his word, and he will be faithful till the end. So right now, with every head bowed, every eye closed, and there's people watching online, I want to right now just give people here today an opportunity to build your house on the rock of Jesus Christ, on a firm foundation. On a foundation when the winds come and the waves come, that it will not be destroyed. So right now, with every head bowed, every eye closed, I want to give you an opportunity to ask Jesus into your heart as Lord and Savior of your life. Or maybe you once knew him that way and you need to rededicate your life to Jesus. Say, Jesus hasn't been Lord of my life. Jesus hasn't been Savior of my life. We want to give you that opportunity today to say, Jesus, I need you to be Lord of my life. Or Jesus, I need to rededicate my life to you. Because there's no greater thing you can do in times like this than lean into God, not away from God. Because God is always faithful. God is always good. And God will always be true to his word. So with every head bowed, every eye closed, when I count to three, if you need to give your life to Jesus or rededicate your life to Jesus, we want to give you that opportunity. And Marilyn would want you to have this opportunity because she was a woman of faith. One, I just speak life and life abundantly. Two, I break every chain of the devil. This is your moment. If you need to give your life to Jesus or rededicate your life to Jesus, just slip your hand up right now and say, that's me. Three. Hands are going up. And if you're online, would you raise your hand if you need to give your life to Jesus or rededicate your life to Jesus? I want people to repeat after me. Everyone in this room and everyone online, if you raise your hand, and everyone that's actually in this room, would you just say this with me? Would you say, Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart and live. I give you everything. I love you, Jesus. I praise you, Jesus. Jesus, I know you died for my sins. And I know you have a plan for my life. I love you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Right now, let me just pray for everyone that's here today and everyone online. So right now, I want to just pray a prayer blessing that we can consider Marilyn's life, that we can consider Christ as we leave here. And I hope that you consider yourself. So right now, I just pray for peace that passes all understanding. May the joy of the Lord be your strength as we celebrate a great woman of faith, a woman of God, a woman that loved Jesus, a woman that loved others, a woman that was dedicated to the mission of Jesus Christ. I pray that we celebrate her life today. I pray that we remember all the good things. I pray that her life impacts you and your family for generations to come. I pray that she has left a spiritual lineage, that lineage will never be broken, because that lineage was birthed from Jesus. And we're grateful that the lineage she left of so many spiritual sons and daughters, as we saw Jimmy sing today, that's a spiritual son of the faith. And we just declare the goodness of Jesus. We declare the mercies of God. We declare the favor of Jesus over your life. We declare that no weapon formed against you shall prosper. We declare the best is yet to come. And we declare that we will continue to love people the way Maryland has loved people. I speak blessing and favor over your life. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. I'm going to have Pastor Rob conclude the service now. But it was an honor to serve this family. And I just want to say this from our church. It was an honor to be open and to be here for you in this time. It was a blessing for us. And if you need anything, please let us know.
Amen. Thank you, Pastor. Like Pastor Brian said, that's the conclusion of our celebration of life here in the sanctuary. And in a few moments, the fellowship hall right behind you, you go through some glass doors, we'll have some people out there to help assist you, guide you back there. It'll be open, and the family would like, if anybody would like to just come through the casket and give any final viewings as you make your way to the fellowship hall. But again, on behalf of our church, thank you so much for being here this morning. On behalf of the family, I know that your presence here meant the world. So again, that concludes our services in the sanctuary. God bless you.
lontana, sogno all'orizzonte, manca le parole. Io sì lo so che sei con me, tu mia luna, tu sei qui con me. Mio sole, tu sei qui con me, con me.
Wonderful to hear all of the stories today, and it helped me to know her a little bit better. And since my mother doesn't get to hear me sing very often, this is why I'm roped into doing this.
Oh Lord, my God, when I know.
Oh.
Grazie. Io vorrei il maestro Candrelli qui, tutti i miei amici, e vorrei qui anche l'infaticabile Veronica che è stata al mio fianco, davanti e dietro sempre per questa avventura. Comunque tutti coloro che sono stati con noi possono venire sul palco qui. Grazie. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.